All right, this tutorial is about REDOX reactions, which is an abbreviation for oxidation reduction reactions. We're going to look at terminology and definitions, what the exchange of electrons looks like, what are half reactions, what are oxidizing and reducing agents, what the connection of the macro level, in other words, the way we experience an actual REDOX reaction to what particles are actually doing, and then finally some practice problems. So oxidation reduction. During a chemical reaction, there is a change in the position or location of valence electrons, and that is what is called oxidation reduction, or redox for short. There can be a transfer of electrons from one atom to another atom, and that would be a redox reaction. What your textbook calls single replacement reactions always involve a transfer of electrons, and so those are redox reactions. And this video is concerned specifically with reactions that involve a transfer of electrons. So an example, here's a single replacement, calcium reacting with iron 2 nitrate to produce calcium nitrate and iron. And then there can also be partial electron transfers during the rearrangement of atoms and covalent compounds. Those are also oxidation reduction reactions, but we will not specifically address those kinds of partial transfers in this tutorial. And an example of that would be a simple combustion reaction, our example here being methane combustion. So as an example of a redox reaction, we will take a look at the reaction of iron metal with aqueous copper 2 chloride. Here's the reaction, but if you look just at the reaction, it doesn't really give you enough information to really understand how electron transfer is occurring. You really have to break it up into what particles are actually involved in the reaction. So we can see that there's iron metal, and that is going to lose two electrons in order to become an iron 2 plus product. And then there's the copper 2 plus reactant. That's going to gain two electrons to become a copper metal product. So there's our transfer of electrons. And we're going to take a much closer view at the particle level to see how particles interacting with each other result in this transfer of electrons. But before we do that, we'll look at how we experience the reaction ourselves. What does this transfer of electrons from iron to copper 2 plus actually look like if we are watching the reaction? So here's solid copper 2 chloride, CuCl2. It's a bit greenish bluish. We're going to drop it into distilled water and dissolve it. Keep in mind that the dissolving means that you no longer have copper chloride. You have copper ions, individual copper ions and chloride ions in solution. Here's the nail, a nice silver nail made out of iron. We're going to drop the nail into the copper chloride solution. And over time, over a few minutes, there's a time lapse here, but this took place over several minutes, you can see the copper forming on the surface of the nail where the iron is, and that's where the reaction is taking place. So the nice reddish-brown copper can be seen here on that part of the nail, which is in the solution. The part above the nail is still that nice silvery color, and you can see a side view there. And so here's the nail again out of solution. You can see the border between where the nail was in the solution and where it was out of solution. Okay, so let's go back to where we started in the video. We have a solution of copper 2 chloride, and as we talked about in the video, since it's aqueous, we actually have individual copper 2 plus ions and individual chloride ions that are independent of each other, surrounded by water molecules. So that's what we're starting with, the aqueous CuCl2, which is actually individual copper ions and chloride ions. And we are going to drop in an nail for our source of iron. All right. So the question is, how will the copper 2 plus ions react with the iron in the nail? If we take a very close look at this reaction of iron metal with aqueous copper 2 chloride, we might get an answer to that question. So let's zoom in here. And you can see the water is there, but it's always there, and it's not quite participating in the reaction. It's solvating the ions, it's allowing them to move, it provides a medium for the reaction, but for convenience, we will no longer show the water molecules. So here we are at a magnification of about a billion, and we've got copper ions floating around, we've got chloride ions floating around, and we've got solid iron from the nail that is just sitting there. So how will the reaction take place? Well, if a copper 2 plus ion collides with an iron atom in the nail, that's going to be where the reaction takes place. As a result of the collision, as you can see, there are two electrons that are being given up by the iron, and those two electrons will be taken by the copper 2 plus. These are valence electrons from the iron solid, and as the copper 2 plus picks up those electrons, it becomes copper metal, neutral copper. And the result is you have an iron 2 plus ion, and that iron 2 plus ion is now soluble. It's able to be solvated by the water molecules. It will flow away from the nail, while the copper atom is now neutral and no longer soluble. It is now copper metal. So this keeps happening over and over again. As copper 2 plus reacts with iron, the copper metal builds up. It's not aqueous. And the Fe2 plus also builds up, but that is aqueous, and so it goes off into solution. So as we saw in the video before, where the reaction takes place is where we see the copper form, and the reaction takes place on the surface of the nail, and so that is where we see the formation of copper metal. But what about the chloride? What is the chloride doing? Has the chloride done anything at all during this whole process? And the answer is no. So chloride is a spectator ion. It really does not participate in the reaction at all. The reaction is only between copper ions and iron atoms from the nail. So this was our oxidation reduction. The iron transferring two electrons to the copper. And so the iron is oxidized, it loses electrons, and the copper is reduced, it gains electrons. So here's the really cool thing. If you let the reaction go long enough in a more concentrated solution of copper chloride, you get this giant mass of copper around the nail. Look at what happens to the iron. The iron is turned into soluble iron ions that have left the nail, and therefore we see the nail reduced in bulk. The iron from the nail has gone away into solution due to its oxidation, making it soluble in the solution. While simultaneously, the soluble copper ions were reduced to copper metal. And here a quick comparison to the particle level. You can see here that the nail slowly loses iron atoms as the reaction takes place and the copper metal builds up around it. So here are the products as we would see them from the written equation, and here are the reactants. The iron metal is oxidized, and as we said before, oxidized means losing electrons. So it is oxidized by the copper 2 plus. The copper 2 plus is the oxidizer. It's the one that takes the electron. It has caused the iron to become oxidized. And here the iron metal becomes an Fe2 plus ion when it is oxidized, when it loses electrons. So this is our oxidation. The iron has lost electrons and it has become oxidized. This is the process of oxidation. And our oxidation is neutral iron becoming iron 2 plus. Let's take a look at the copper. So the copper 2 plus ion is reduced, the definition of reduced being a gain of electrons, and it's reduced by the iron metal. The iron metal has given the electrons to the copper 2 plus, and therefore we call the iron the reducer. It has reduced the copper 2 plus. It has given it electrons. So the copper 2 plus becomes copper metal, neutral copper metal, when it is reduced, when it gains electrons. So here is the reduction. The species that gain electrons is where the reduction occurs. And there's the oxidation. Remember, an oxidation is a loss of electrons, and the reduction is a gain of electrons. What's the chloride doing? Absolutely nothing. It's a spectator. It's basically irrelevant to our oxidation reduction. So here's where we get into half reactions. We're just showing the half of the total reaction, that is the oxidation here. And here's the half reaction that is just showing the reduction. So the half reaction of oxidation is the iron becoming iron 2 plus, giving up 2 electrons. The half reaction of reduction is the copper 2 plus gaining 2 electrons and becoming copper metal. So if we look at charges, we call these oxidation numbers. Oxidation numbers here are exactly the same as the charge on the atom. The iron metal has no charge, so we give it an oxidation number of 0. And after losing electrons, the iron has a 2 plus charge, so it has an oxidation number of plus 2. All right, let's look at the reduction. Copper starts out with a 2 plus charge, and so it has an oxidation number of plus 2, and it ends up with no charge after gaining electrons, and so it has an oxidation number of 0. It's neutral. And as we said, these are called oxidation numbers. But for ions and neutral compounds, it's just exactly the charge on the atom. All right, so the two half reactions, it's an oxidation reduction reaction. Half of it is an oxidation, the other half is a reduction. So here are the two half reactions. If you add them together, the two electrons on the right side cancel out the two electrons on the left, and you end up with the net reaction, which is the reaction without chloride present, because the chloride is actually not participating in the reaction. So we have iron reacting with copper 2 plus, and that produces iron 2 plus and copper. That's the net reaction. And I like to think of the net reaction as, how do we symbolically represent what the reaction actually is, rather than writing CuCl2 and FeCl2 when the chloride actually isn't participating. So the net reaction focuses our attention to what is actually going on in the redox reaction. All right, a little more vocabulary: oxidizing agent, reducing agent. So the thing that gets oxidized, in this case the iron, is called the reducing agent because it's giving the electrons that it loses to the copper, which is getting reduced. So we call the iron the reducing agent. And the other side of the coin is the species that is getting reduced, the copper 2 plus, is getting reduced by taking electrons from the iron. And so by taking electrons, it is oxidizing the other substance, and therefore it is the oxidizing agent. So the species getting oxidized, in this case iron, is the reducing agent. And the species getting reduced, in this case the copper 2 plus, is the oxidizing agent. That is always the case. Whatever is getting oxidized is the reducing agent. Whatever is getting reduced is the oxidizing agent. So here's our oxidation, and here's our reduction. So let's take a look at some other reactions and practice what we've learned in this tutorial about how to identify the oxidation in a reaction, the reduction in a reaction, what are the half reactions, identify reducing agents and oxidizing agents, as well as identifying how many electrons are being exchanged in a balanced reaction. All right, let's apply what we just learned in the video. We'll look at several reactions, and for each reaction we'll write the ionic and net equations, look at what the oxidation and reduction is, write the half reactions, figure out how many total electrons are exchanged, and figure out the oxidizing agent and the reducing agent. So let's keep in mind that oxidation is a loss of electrons, and reduction is a gain of electrons. All right, let's start with, you guessed it, balancing the reaction. Just as in the video, this is a single replacement reaction. We need two chlorides on this side. That gives us two potassium, so we'll put a 2 there. That balances the equation. The first question, ionic and net equations. So the ionic is going to be, well, we've got two solid potassiums, and we've got aqueous calcium 2 plus ion. Remember, this is aqueous, so the ions are split apart, two aqueous chloride ions. That's going to result in two potassium ions that are aqueous, and again, two aqueous chloride ions, plus, finally, solid calcium metal. So the net equation is really specifically the reaction itself. So we're getting rid of what's not reacting. And what's not reacting, we can see on both sides, the chloride has not changed. It's still the same. It hasn't done anything. So we're just going to get rid of it. And so the net equation is going to be what's left over. Two potassiums reacting with calcium ions, and that gives us two potassium ions plus calcium metal. All right, B is asking for what is the oxidation and what is the reduction? Well, potassium goes from a neutral metal to an ion, and that means it has lost electrons. So that's the oxidation. Calcium 2 plus ion has gained electrons to become calcium metal, and a gain of electrons is reduction. So the half reaction for oxidation is going to be two potassiums gives us 2K plus ions and 2 electrons. And the reduction is going to be calcium 2 plus ions gaining 2 electrons, and that gives us calcium metal. Now if we add these two half reactions, that will get us the net equation that we see right there. D, it's asking how many total electrons are exchanged. Well, we can see that 2 electrons have been exchanged in the balanced reaction. And then finally, for E, the oxidizing agent and reducing agent. Here, the reducing agent is going to be potassium. It is giving electrons to calcium, and therefore it is reducing calcium. The oxidizing agent is the calcium. It has taken electrons from potassium, and therefore it has reduced potassium. One thing to note is a common mistake that students make. They often just write the metal itself, not the ion. It is the calcium 2 plus ion that is the oxidizer. Metals themselves are not oxidizing agents. They don't take electrons. It is their positive ions that are able to take electrons and become reduced. All right, so we're going to do 3 more equations. The first one will be single replacement again, but the last two are a little bit different. The reaction between a metal and a nonmetal, and that's going to be a bit different. So make sure you stay tuned for those. For this one, why don't you copy it down, turn off the video, and try to do it yourself, and then come back and check your answer. All right, I hope you balance the equation. We've got two aluminums on the right, so we'll put a 2 there. There's 3 sulfates on the right, so we'll put a 3 there, and then 3 zincs on the right. For A, or the ionic and the net, the ionic, we're going to split apart what's aqueous into individual ions. So 3 zinc 2 plus ions that are aqueous, plus 3 sulfate ions, aqueous, and then we have 2 aluminum metal. And on the right, aqueous aluminum sulfate means we have 2 aluminum 3 plus ions that are aqueous. That's from the 2 right there. We've got 3 sulfates, and then finally 3 solid zinc. Now, as before, you eliminate anything that hasn't changed from the reactant side to the product side. So we get rid of the sulfates, and everything left in the reaction has undergone some sort of change. In particular, with redox, it's a transfer of electrons. So the net is going to be what's left. 3 zinc, 2 plus, reacting with 2 aluminums, gives us 2 aluminum ions plus 3 zinc metal. B, the oxidation and the reduction. Well, let's take a look at the zinc. The zinc has taken electrons from the aluminum, so it has gained electrons, so that's the reduction. And the aluminum has lost those electrons, so it has become oxidized, so that's the oxidation. See the half reactions. For the oxidation, we have two aluminums losing electrons. Each aluminum loses three electrons, and there's two aluminums, so it loses a total of six electrons. For the reduction, there's three zinc 2+ ions. Each zinc ion gains two electrons, and there's three ions, so it has to gain a total of six electrons to make three solid zinc atoms. How many electrons are transferred? So six electrons transferred. And finally, E, the oxidizing agent and reducing agent. So the reducing agent is the aluminum. The aluminum gave electrons to the zinc, and it reduced the zinc. By doing that, the oxidizing agent, the zinc 2+, took electrons from the aluminum, causing the aluminum to be oxidized. So zinc 2+ is the oxidizing agent. Again, remember, it's not zinc metal, it's the zinc 2+ ion. Don't forget the charge. Otherwise, you're saying that it's something else. Okay, the next thing is a reaction between a metal and a nonmetal. Here, aluminum and fluorine react to produce aluminum fluoride, an ionic compound. And there are no species that are not involved in the reaction in the equation. So the whole equation itself is basically a net equation. So we're going to skip that. The equation is showing everything that's... So we're going to go right to B, but before we get to B, of course, we have to balance the equation. We have an odd and even number of fluorine, so we're going to take the least common multiple. That's 3 and 2, giving us 2 aluminums over there. Now let's look at the charge that we're starting with. On the aluminum, that's a metal, so it starts with it's a neutral charge, and fluorine is also neutral. But it becomes an aluminum fluoride ionic compound. The aluminum is a 3+ ion, and the fluoride is a 1- ion. So there has definitely been a transfer of electrons. So what is the oxidation and what is the reduction? Well, the aluminum starts out as neutral and loses electrons. So that's the oxidation. The fluorine starts out neutral and it gains electrons to become a negative ion. Gaining electrons is being reduced. So that's the reduction. The half reactions. Well, the oxidation, the aluminum lost electrons. Each aluminum lost 3 electrons, and there's a total of 2 aluminums. So from the balanced equation, it lost a total of 6 electrons. The reduction, therefore, is the 3 fluorines. Each fluorine gains 1 electron, and there are a total of 6 fluorines, 3F2, so there's a total of 6 electrons gained, and that makes 2 F3s from the equation. So D, we've got 6 electrons transferred total in the balanced reaction. And finally, E, the oxidizing agent is going to be F2. F2 has taken electrons from an aluminum, so it's oxidizing aluminum. And the reducing agent, the aluminum, has given electrons to the fluorine. It has reduced the fluorine. All right, we're going to do one more. Why don't you write this down and try it? So try it on your own and stop the video and then come back and see how you do. All right, here again we have a reaction between a metal and a nonmetal. And we, of course, have to balance it. We've got 2 oxygens on the left, so we'll put a 2 there, and that's going to be 4 sodium, so 4 over there. B, what's the oxidation, what's the reduction? Well, again, let's look at what we're starting with in terms of charge. The sodium metals are always no charge, they're neutral. The oxygen molecule, it's a molecule, there's no charge. They come together and make an ionic compound. Each sodium has a 1+ charge, and each oxygen has a 2- charge. So the sodium loses electrons, so that's the oxidation, and the oxygen has gained electrons, And so that's the reduction. See the half reactions? The oxidation from the balanced reaction, there's four sodiums, and each sodium loses an electron to become sodium plus, so that's a total of four electrons lost. The reduction, O2, each oxygen atom is going to gain two electrons, and there's two oxygen atoms, so that's a total of four electrons, and that gives us two oxygen 2 minus atoms. D, the amount of electrons transferred, there's four electrons transferred. And then finally E, the oxidizing agent. Ah, can you guess? It's oxygen. Oxygen will always be the oxidizer in a redox reaction. So oxygen has taken electrons from sodium. It has oxidized sodium. The reducing agent, of course, then is sodium. It has given electrons to oxygen, thus reducing the oxygen.